Thank you for the invitation to Princeton. I'm very happy to be here and very happy to be back. So my talk splits up into approximately two parts. And in the first part, I'll talk about small sums. As described in the title of my talk. And this will cover also work that I started while I was here 3 years ago in Princeton. And the second part will be an application more or less of the first part. Okay, so what am I talking about? More general terms. So I'll just start out with some basic objects, namely five roots of unity in the complex numbers. And so we assume that they have order dividing some integer n, or some natural number n. OK, and so the question, the basic question that I'm going at is was posed by Meyerson, Jerry Meyerson, I think in the late 1970s or early 1980s. And he asked if the sum of these five guys here is non-zero, how small can it be? So how small is the modulus? At least in terms of n. So you let n go to infinity and see how small can you get this sum as a function of n. And so there's also an easy approach to this problem. Namely, just take note that this is an algebraic integer. And so its norm has to be at least 1 in absolute value. That means if you take the product of the conjugates of this sum, you'll get something whose absolute value is at least 1. And each term in this product, apart from this one here, has absolute value at most 5, because all conjugates of a root of unity are at most 5. So the easy bound is something that's exponential in n, namely 5 to the minus n. This is the trivial bound. So if you want to be a bit more sophisticated, you can replace this by minus 5 of n, the field generated by the roots of unity of order n. But still, it's going to be exponential in this quantity n. So the question is, can you do better than something exponential in n? So not the 5 is a problem, but somehow can you do something sub-exponential? And well, you can see what happens if you have, instead of 5, if you have if you have one root of unity, it's clear, then the absolute value is 1. If you have two roots of unity, this is also easy. You get essentially 1 over n. If you have three roots of unity, it's a bit harder, but it's still an exercise that can be solved by maybe undergraduate students. If you have three roots of unity, essentially what you're looking at is an almost triangle. Namely, you have a sum 1 plus zeta 1 plus zeta 2. Because in this problem, of course, you can always assume that zeta 1 is 1. So you're trying to create a triangle whose angles here are rational multiples of pi, and you want it not to be a triangle, but almost a triangle. And some easy geometry shows that you can get 1 over n up to a constant here. So this distance will grow like 1 over n, or decrease like 1 over n. And for four roots of unity, there's also a trick, a geometric trick, that shows that Well, you don't get something like 1 over n, but you get 1 over n squared. But starting with 5 terms, these tricks don't work anymore. So here, for 4 terms, you're essentially looking at something like a rhombus, an almost rhombus. This is somehow the optimal situation. And then it's not hard to see that you get 1 over n squared. But for 5 terms, nothing essentially better than this exponential decay is known. And so I can at least write down a folklore conjecture. So I don't know who to attribute this to. And it says, well, I guess it's reasonable to expect that you can assume or you can expect polynomial decay for any number, not only 5, but any n. So there exists, for any natural number n, there exists some exponent, lambda of n, such that if I have a certain number of roots of unity, n, and they don't sum up to 0, then their absolute value, the absolute value of the sum will be bounded from below by n to the minus lambda. So the constant here, and this just means this is at least some constant times this expression here, this constant will depend on or may depend on n, but the growth should be polynomial. As I said, nothing beyond, nothing better than an exponential bound is known. I think not even, you can't even replace this by small o of n for general n when you have 5 terms or more. So this is open.
It's not a conjecture about the size of this lambda.
There could be, because people have constructed small sums of roots of unity. And you can look at what they construct, and you can maybe say that these constructions are best possible. But I don't think there are any conjectures on that, because I couldn't even find this here as a conjecture in the literature.
Are there many numerics out there?
Excuse me?
Are there many numerics out there?
So there are ways to construct small sums where they decrease polynomially in n with a certain exponent. So you'd know, you'd have a lower bound for this lambda n if the conjecture is true by these exponents. But I don't know if there's a reasonable value for this exponent.
So
or
it's not believed to be 3 in 5
It could be, but I'm not sure. I could check these computations. Okay. So there's somehow, at the moment at least, no hope for anything sub-exponential here. But I want to at least talk about some evidence towards this conjecture. And this evidence, just from its nature, will also include an exponent, but about which I can say absolutely nothing, just from the way the thing is proved. OK, sorry. Like this. So that's the following theorem. Just call it theorem 1. And well, it also involves an epsilon. Is arbitrary, then exists a constant depending on n and epsilon with the following property. If p is a prime, and I have pth roots of unity, so the order is either 1 or more than p, then the following holds. The set of all conjugates of a sum like that, that are small in absolute value, is very, very sparse. So I'm looking at the set of all conjugates of a sum of n roots of unity, where this sum is, well, it's, I don't want it to be 0, of course, and otherwise it'll always be zero. And I want it to be less or equal to some power of p. Then this here will be bounded by p to the epsilon as p goes to infinity here. So in fact, Igor Sparlinsky pointed out that this condition is not necessary for p-thirds of unity here for large p. So it's rather, you have a sparse set of counterexamples, at least in a single Galois orbit, if the order is a prime. So I'll just give a slight hint at how to prove something like this. And so the roots of unity I write as values of the exponential function at rational multiples of 2 pi I. So I can write it as a rational multiple, as a some quotient where the denominator is p. And need a bigger blackboard now. So the basic observation is if I have a sum like this here, and I want, well, I'll assume that the first term here is 1. So if this is small, I'll say in a moment what that is, also smaller than some constant kappa, then this vector here, x1 to xn, it will lie close to the set defined by where this expression here vanishes. Yeah, this will lie close to, put this in apostrophe, to capital X. And this is just the solution set here. Of the equation 1 plus whatever I have to write down equals 0. Right. So what does this, I mean, what does lie close mean? Lies close means that the distance, if the value here is less than kappa, then the distance will be bounded by something polynomial in kappa. So delta is some constant that depends only on n, the number of terms. And this is, I mean, this carries a name, this is Loyazovich inequality. From real geometry. So I guess from a geometric point of view, we have a certain set X, which would be the zero set of some real analytic function restricted to the unit hypercube. This would be zero, X would be actually in here. And then I have a certain point, lowercase x, that's somehow close to my uppercase X. And this lowercase x here, in the application, it's a rational vector. So it's a denominator P. So what kind of structure can we attach to X? Well, X is not really real analytic because we're restricting it to some compact set here. It's not real analytic, but X is the intersection of a real analytic set with this hypercube here. And this is a set that, this kind of set appears in the theory of O-minimal structures. This is what is called a set that's definable in Rn. I'm not really going to talk about O-minimal structures here. But I want to advertise it a bit because it's something, a concept that makes makes this type of argument possible. So what you can think of as something defined in Rn is just a set that kind of looks real analytic, but maybe you have to intersect it with something like this hypercube. So it's a set you can somehow work with, which is sufficiently tame in applications. And I also want to make, even Blackboard. So if the distance here happens to be 0, if I'm on the set X here, then I'm just looking at rational points on this real analytic set here. And this situation is covered by a powerful theorem due to Pilo-Wilkie, proved in, I think, published in 07. And the theorem says the following, and this was also motivation for my work here, that if I have a subset of R to the n and definable in a nominal structure, and some constant epsilon, some small epsilon. And for simplicity, just for sake of this talk, I'll assume that the set here, you can think it as something real analytic. And I want it to be as analytic as possible, so I don't want it to contain anything that's anything that's algebraic. So I assume it's not going to contain any semi-algebraic curves. It's as transcendental as possible. Just to make the theorem easier to formulate. If you can also cover this case, the more general case, without this hypothesis. So then the theorem is that if you look at points, rational points on this set that are really on the set, then there are too many. But if you look at those of bounded height, then the number will grow as t to the epsilon for large t. And the height here is just the very naive height. If I have two integers that are coprime, then it'll be the maximum of both. And if you have a vector, then you'll just take the maximal height of an entry of the vector. So you can define what the height is on q to the n.
By the way, nothing has ever been made effective, but in principle, I mean, I've discussed it with Peter many times, is the fact that you don't know what lambda is for the same reason of this being,
In a sense, yeah. So that's, I think there is, it's not easy to make this effective, yeah. I don't know. I don't think it's just a matter of laziness.
It's not sort of ineffective in the way that zeros.
Yeah, that's. I think that's maybe not at that level. No,
yeah.
But it's not at the level
you see,
of.
When you put a finiteness statement like Andre Ort, and you then have to give a lower bound on L functions, then it becomes much more serious.
Yeah. That's an additional. Certainly an additional. But I don't think it's just a matter of not working hard enough. I think there really is a problem here. And so this theorem itself was a culmination of work of many people that goes back to the beginning of the 20th century, starting from Jarnik and then Bombieri-Pila, who treated the case of curves, and later Pila treated some surfaces. And this version here has the advantage that you can treat more general sets that are definable. So you have a large class of sets you can work with, sets like that here, where the dimension is going to be large in general, n minus 2 or something. OK, so that's the additional kind of flexibility we need to work with sets like X comes from O minimality. But it has the potential of introducing questions of effectivity. This is also all based on earlier work. And there was a lot of applications of this here, this theorem to problems as mentioned by Peter, coming from diophantine geometry and based on ideas of Peter Sarnak and Roberto Zagnier, who used this kind of results to prove things in arithmetic geometry.
Yeah. So the zero set over there, maybe I'm mistaken, but it's sort of periodic.
Yeah.
Does this theorem in any way take advantage of that, or do you just basically take any real analytic?
So I'm restricting it somehow to the fundamental domain. Yeah. And so the thing is that I did a lot of advertising for O-minimality, but the thing it can't deal with is exactly periodicity. So that's kind of beyond the reach of this theory. For that reason, you really have to restrict to 0, 1. But it's true that many methods, many ideas in the proof will somehow use it, but you can't work with a complete set and hope that it's still definable. Yeah. Right. So what we actually need for a problem like this here, counting is just a version where you're not on x, but you're just approximating x. And so that would be the second theorem. And well, it's kind of similar to the first one. But you have stronger restrictions, which are necessary. You have to assume that it's a closed subset, because we'll explain in a moment. And definable in Rn. So here are definable in any O-minimal structure, and here I'll just, for the sake of the talk, I'll restrict to this one here, because you can't allow stuff like exponential growth and still expect this theorem to hold. Same hypothesis, x does not contain any semi-algebraic curve. And then there exists an exponent such that now if you count points, on q to the n of bounded height, whose distance to x is bounded by t to the minus lambda, then this will grow by t to the epsilon. So the number of points that approximate the set up to some t to the epsilon tubular neighborhood will grow like t to the epsilon. So this is, of course, a constant involved here. And this exponent here, lambda, comes from certain compactness arguments and can't really be specified. Again, this hypothesis here on semi-algebraic curves, you can remove it at the cost of making the statement more complicated. You get a subset of x. You can define the set of algebraic locus of x as all points in x that are contained in a connected semi-algebraic curve. You have to remove that, and you also have to remove a certain neighborhood of that to get the correct counting result. Okay. And of course, now then, if you want to use the theorem here to get this one, well, you just have to use this set here and observe that, well, the point I had before was in 0, 1, and had denominator p, so the height of this point here will essentially be p.
You're not giving a new proof of p, but will p, you're using it. Your theorem contains it.
Formally, it probably contains it. Yeah. So, but the argument had to be redone. So you can't reduce to this theorem. You have to redo the argument and introduce some additional uniformity at certain steps. Yeah. But so if you just boil it down to this situation where...
Quite stunning that you can perturb the inequality. The land is very large.
Yeah, it's unspecifiedly large. So there may not be enough protons in the universe to contain the information in lambda. Who knows? So, right, so this will be essentially the height. So you're looking at stuff that's close. And by Lojazovic, you're not really going to lose much by passing from this being close to the distance, because that just introduces another polynomial exponent here. So that's how to get from theorem 2 to theorem 1. Okay. So that kind of, that's the first part of the talk. And the second part is on Gaussian periods. And so the result in the second part, we're motivated by the things coming from the first part. So people who know this method that I was talking about before, the nice thing about this theorem here, the applications it has to Diophantine geometry, is that once you have a single point on something something trans or definable here, then you can always use a Galois group to define new points. This isn't possible here in general because, well, if you have a small sum like this and if you let the Galois group act, you're gonna mess that up. The only thing that, of course, works is using complex conjugation, but that's just one automorphism. You need a lot more to actually get anything done. So to use kind of ideas in this direction, you have to somehow force yourself to look at all conjugates at the same time. And so what is a Gaussian period? Start again with a prime P. And I'll just define e to the 2 pi I over P. And Galois group would just be the multiplicative group of FP. And we're going to look at the subgroup G of order n. So G will be some sort of n elements. It's going to be a group.
Sorry, I missed something very basic. Where did you use the case? You said you only solved this other problem for primes?
Yeah, yeah.
Where are we using that?
Good question. So I glossed over this semi-algebraic curve here.
Yeah.
And in fact, the theorem that you have for general x requires a bit more care to formulate. And this set here, x, will contain semi-algebraic curves. This is known. How to find them is also known. This is done using axis theorem. So they come essentially from certain kinds of linear relations among the t's here with rational coefficients. But doing the induction step requires that we work with primes. Yeah, they cause the problems, yeah. Yep. Right. Okay, so this is
is this something you feel you can still do? Like solve the Meyerson problem?
I mean,
it deals with this stuff.
It just deals with the prime power order. So
okay.
I've been thinking about the general case, but still blocked there just because of the special, some of these special sub for coming from axis theorem. That's still an obstruction, yeah. And unfortunately, it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that we don't know what these semi-algebraic curves are. We do know what they are. But somehow exploding their nature is at the moment not doable. OK. So this is a setup, just a subgroup here of FP, and right this way. And a Gaussian period attached to this data is just, well, it's just the sum of these powers of zeta. Of course, this is all well defined because this is order p and this is fp. And these guys here, they appear as, for example, traces of zeta with respect to the fixed fields attached to this subgroup here. And well, they're just for sanity check, if g equals fp star, well, you're taking everything, so you get minus 1. If the index is 2, so if we're looking at exactly the squares in fp star, then, well, this is a theorem of Gauss. And let me see if I can get the sign correct. It's always a problem. Minus 1 Yeah, I don't know the sign. It's plus or minus one depending on p modulo 4. This is due to Gauss. So you can compute these guys if the index is small, and I think an expression is known up to index 4. But actually, we're going to be interested in what happens if the group is small, right? If n is small. That was the situation we were in before. We have a sum of n roots, m roots of unity. So n is now fixed. We want n fixed. Because this method can't deal with varying n. So somehow the other extreme, and in this extreme, it's not reasonable to be able to expect a general expression for these Gaussian periods. So let's look at an example. This is g equals n equals 3. The first interesting example. So these groups are always cyclic, so it's just 1 theta and theta squared. And what Meyerson proved in 1980 is the following. So you're looking at this short sum here of 3 roots of unity. And you're taking Ogawa conjugates. And summing over the logs. And you got p minus 1 terms, so you normalize it by dividing by p minus 1. So what this actually is just the log of the norm of the Gaussian period normalized by the field degree. And so this guy here, so this is a sum. You're summing over, well, you can think of these as a point of finite order in GM cubed, and you're summing over log of a certain polynomial evaluated at all Galois conjugates of this point of finite order, and then you divide by p minus 1. So if you believe that these points here are all somehow nicely equidistributed around the maximal compact subgroup, you should expect this sum here, or this average, to converge to some integral. And space, and that's actually what happens. And what Meyerson proves is that this converges here to the Mahler measure.
I guess he was using a little geometric exercise.
Exactly. That's it. So he proved that converges to the Mahler measure of a polynomial x1 plus x2 plus x3. And if I write down what the Mahler measure is, you'll see the integral. So this is just triple integral over over what I have here, but then evaluated at points on the unit circle that kind of move independently of each other. So this is a triple integral. It converges even though there are singularities, because this can actually attain zero, the value zero. It still converges, and the value is known to be the Dirichlet L function, or its derivative evaluated at the point minus 1. If you take the non-trivial character mod 3. Excuse me?
So it does not depend on theta,
so this is p goes to infinity, and of course you need to take p equals or equivalent to 1 mod 3 because you have a subgroup of order 3. But you're infinitely many primes at that time. So the limit, yeah, you're letting p vary here and taking the average over. So you can actually compute this value. It's positive, which is somewhat relevant later on. And Duke He gave a second proof of this, and he also gave an error term, so he got log p divided by square root of p. Yeah. So what's the idea behind this? So look at this sum here, or this average. We have to write it down in another slightly different way. And I'll just sum over full FP, because that really doesn't make a difference in the average. And what you're actually doing, you're evaluating some polynomial here at all conjugates of zeta. And this polynomial, well, you just take it, for example, you could take x plus x to the theta plus x to the theta squared. Well, you write tildes because you have integral values or representatives of these elements here. So this will be a polynomial in x. And you're evaluating it at all conjugates of zeta. And this is also an easy algebra exercise. You can, using the resultant, this is the same thing as if you sum over all roots of alpha of a, roots of this polynomial, and you plug these roots into the polynomial at which all these guys here vanish, namely just x to the p minus 1. You can't forget the log. This is just using resultant. A basic identity. right, and so this guy here, you're taking something to the pth power minus 1, and then you're log and then divide by p. So this should morally be the same thing as log of max 1 comma the absolute value of alpha. If alpha is large absolute value, then the pth power will push it away. And you'll essentially get p times log of absolute value of alpha. And then you divide by p, so you get this. And if p is very small in absolute value, then this expression will be essentially 1. Logarithm will be essentially 0, and it won't contribute. So this should be equal, but up to some error term, which we want to make have small. So this the crucial part, of course, is in controlling the error term here. Because once you have an expression like this, this is nothing else other than the Mahler measure of the polynomial alpha a. And the Mahler measure of the polynomial a is essentially the Mahler measure of x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus small o of 1. And this is due to Lawton. So the Mahler measure of a univariate polynomial will converge to this Mahler measure of a three-variable polynomial by Lawton. So getting Meyerson's theorem essentially means controlling this error term here. And what goes wrong, or what's a difficult part? So error term is. As I explained before, if alpha is an absolute value very large or very, very small, then we're OK. So the error term is small if alpha is large or small. Right? But if alpha is close in absolute value to 1, then we could get into trouble. So what if alpha to the p is almost 1? If we're close to the singularity of log, That's going to be the hard case. If alpha to the p is almost 1, then alpha would be almost some power of zeta. Because alpha is the root of a, zeta to the p will be almost a root of a. I'm not being very precise here, but I guess what I'm trying to say is that if you want to understand the situation where you can control this error term, it essentially boils down to understanding like roots of unity that are almost zeros of a. And that's exactly, there's exactly roots of unity that, it's exactly a triple sum of roots of unity. So we have to understand the t where this here happens to be small. Yeah, and as pointed out before, Peter, if you know the three term case of sums of roots of unity, if you can get a good lower bound there, you can get a good lower bound here where that's polynomial in p, and then this error term won't really matter because essentially the log will eat up everything because at the end you divide by p. In a certain sense, there are two points.
And a GM3?
Yeah.
But they have some effect on this type of thing, right?
I mean, the point is when you're near the set, you have that polynomial bound because of the log. If the function was smooth, then it would be a good.
Right. But the problem is the logarithm function has a singularity.
Okay.
If you're close to the singularity, you have to somehow be far away, so you're not too close. Right. Otherwise, you'd be out of luck. There'd be no hope. That's a good question. The method doesn't work. Maybe the I think the method probably won't work. But it's a good.
You place about points of small height.
It's small height.
Yeah.
Like a sequence of zeta is a point of small height.
Hmm. So yeah, that's a good question, but I think we're far away from answering that at the moment. So I guess what we need is, at least for the general cases, we need a good understanding that of the distribution of such some of the Galois orbits, and we have essentially we need not too many t's such that will spoil the average, such that. Such that this is exceedingly small. And exceedingly small always means here is much smaller than some power of t. So not too many such t's. Otherwise, we can't hope for the sum to be small. And the second thing is, because we can't, the result I showed in the first part says that, okay, we can have this, but most p to the epsilon. But we still need to treat those. Those that are exceedingly small are not too large in number, but they could be very small. We saw that the lower bound, the only lower bound for five terms is exponential, and that would be too coarse. So for exceptional values or for exceedingly small, we need a non-trivial bound, non-trivial lower bound. So in the three-term case, this comes from the geometric consideration. For starting in five terms, there's not much hope anymore in general, but still some situations where we can say something, namely if n, the number of terms, is an odd prime. And of course we can only look at primes modulo equivalent one mod n, and then we have a subgroup here of index of order n. And well, the result is that if now we take the average over FP star, and as always, we take the log, and now we sum over the elements in G. This will be the Mahler measure of x1 plus xn, plus the error term is something polynomial in p to the 5 n minus 1 squared. So the convergence and the error term, but the counts and then the error term is not effective. This is now the Mahler measure of an n variable polynomial here. This is always positive. This requires a proof, but when I'm using consequences, because this again is nothing other than the norm of the corresponding Gaussian period, or the whole thing. And because this average here converges to something positive, that means that the Gaussian period will only be an algebraic unit finitely many times. Eventually, it'll be non-unit. OK. So maybe just a few words. How does this?
Many of these Mahler measures, which can be evaluated, this is not one that. In all these papers evaluating Mahler measures in terms of special values.
Right.
Habegger, these students, is this not one that has a function of n?
I don't know if it's actually known. I do know that it's known to be positive. This also requires a proof. It could be zero. And it's always greater or equal to zero, but it's actually positive. And for n equals 3, it's, and I think they may have results for small values of n. Great, yeah. And so the theorems in the first part of the talk, they somehow cover this question here. You don't have too many conjugates where this sum is exceedingly small. And what about the second part? For the exceptional conjugates, you still need something. Otherwise, the average would explode. And here, I need an old result of Mahler that tells you something about the distance between two distinct roots of a polynomial in terms of its the Mahler measure of the polynomial. So there's a transcendental input here, or a result, an easy result from transcendence theory that's required for the theorem here. So let me say a few things about the hypothesis on the prime, on n, the number of terms. I said odd prime. It happens that if n is any odd number, I can get convergence, but this won't be the limit. It'll be the Mahler measure of a more complicated polynomial in terms of n. For even n, at least six, it's completely open as far as I know.
So, I mean, that's not a mystery. That's just the equity, the more general case, you can write what that polynomial.
Yeah, it's just, it's not a mystery, right. But it's not as easy to write down. But for the limit, well, Meyerson conjectured what the limit should be for all n. And the method breaks down for even n, though. That's something I'd like to point out. And I think it has to do with this step here, that there's no reasonable way to apply this result of Mahler. Yeah, there's a small savings there, yeah. And well, if you'd have sufficiently strong linear lower bounds for linear forms and logarithms of a particular nature, then you could do it in general. But this is open at the moment. But it doesn't have to be as strong. The version you need is not strong enough to imply ABC, but it's still much stronger than what we have now. Okay. Let me say a few final words about what else is known. So the method at the moment. Breaks down for even and for even term number of terms, except for n equals 4, then you still have the geometric trick. But for n equals 6, it's open. Then there's also a lot of work in this direction by three authors, Lindt, Schmidt, and Verbitsky. And what they do is they look at qualitative expressions. So they have this finite subgroup here of this multiplicative group. And they evaluate polynomials of assuming, of course, it's not zero at these group elements, and then they compute the limits. Converges, and but there's no I think there's no error term here. They use ergodic methods here. And their motivation was to be able to say something about entropy of certain dynamical systems in ergodic theory. So in the result up there, in that theorem up there, G was essentially a cyclic group coming from the Galois orbit here. So G was essentially Well, they have the correct. They have a
They're not including your theorem.
Excuse me?
That seems to be a very general statement that it converges, but if there's something very close which they allow bad guy, they often say I don't understand. They're saying their theorem contains yours.
It contains the limit, but not the error term, as far as I can tell. Yeah.
But then, even to get the limit, if there's one guy that's very close, are they using some transcendence?
Yeah, I don't understand this method too much. I think they must need some kind of transcendence type results.
They have
a different approach to the problem using ergodic methods, which I don't completely understand at the moment. Okay. But they do get the limit here. They do have an hypothesis on F.
Yeah, I don't think they're getting the cases
you're doing from. Yeah, so there is a hypothesis on F.
It's quite a serious hypothesis.
Okay.
Because they're using some transcendence theorem. In other words, I'm pretty sure they're not getting your case or the case that Basile is.
And, okay, the last.
Schmidt told me that himself.
Okay, I haven't spoken to him. And yeah, finally, Vasilin Dmitriev, he wrote me a few emails. And he also has a paper on the archive. And he treats, in this notation, he treats products of groups. G is a product of finite subgroups. Of C star, and whereas here it's essentially a cyclic subgroup of generated by a single element here. And he uses also methods from that are motivated by transcendence theory. Okay, thanks for your attention.